for a whole time. All right. Prevailing wisdom is that it's better to spend quality time than quantity time with your children. Explain why both is necessary.
I'll start off with this time. quantity time, I think is needed because children need to know that you're there. They have a lot of things that they're gonna wanna know that if you're not there to teach it to them, so they'll learn from you, somebody else will teach it. You know, if you're not there to give them quality time, which is necessary, I mean, they're gonna find it somewhere else. So if you're there, show them that you're available when they need you for quality, as much as, what the
quantity.
Quantity. I mean, family that does things together is a family that will always be together. Now, I come from a large family, and some people say we are together too much. You know, we are. We get together, and we love being with each other. That's where we grew up. My dad, my mom, their families always was together. So we're passing it on to our kids so that they'll know the nucleus of a nucleus family, you know, that your family is what you have.
Okay, let me go ahead, and we have a few more questions, so you all might have to answer the same question. The next question is, what steps can fathers take, especially African American fathers, to inspire their children to develop their God-given talents and abilities to the best they can be? Let me repeat that again. What steps can fathers take, especially African American fathers, to inspire their children to develop their God-given talents and abilities to be the best they can be?
We need to teach our children and make sure that they understand their heritage. They need to know where I come from, who my father was, and my mother, and what they did in their lifetime, you know, how they made their living, and how I was raised. If I can, we have to instill in our children what was instilled in us. It may not always been the best things, but we take the good and the bad when we're raised, because that's a part of life. But how we handle the bad, and we instill that in our children, that no matter how things seem or how things appear on the surface, who you are and where you come from will determine who you'll become in your life. And I make it a purpose to let my sons and my grandson know that you have a strong heritage behind you, and you have strong support, not from just from me, but from the church and from the community. And that will help them keep them and guide them in whatever they do.
Great, thank you. That was great. Okay, gentlemen, you're gonna have to think about this one real quick. Let me say it, and then you can take just a few seconds to think about it. I think this is very important. We look at the three little pigs. We look at the story of the three little pigs. We all know the story, hopefully we all know, maybe the younger ones don't know it. But of course there was a house made out of what? A house made out of straw, a house made out of brick, and a house made out of wood. We know how the story goes. We know that the house made out of brick was the house that had the strong foundation that didn't crumble in the event of a crisis or the big bad wolf blowing and huffing and blowing the other houses down. So this is kind of segues into this question. What happens to the family when fathers refuse to be the spiritual leaders in the home they should be? What happens to the families when fathers refuse to be the spiritual leaders in the home that they should be.
It crumbles. For example, when I was a kid, my father, like I say, not to put my father down, but you know, he wasn't there like he should have been. So me and my brother had to rely on, you know, other people to get information and you know, from mothers, a lot of times, you know, mothers can't teach, let me say this carefully, mothers can't teach boys the things that they need for a man, you know. So we had to get a lot of information from, you know, other women, or, but my father wasn't there like he should have been, you know. So, you know, that's what happens when they're not there, it crumbles. When he doesn't do his thing, everything just crumbles, everything stems from the man. For an example, if your water get cut off, you know, a lot of times if daddy's in the home, you know, they're not gonna go looking at, hey, mama, the water's cut off, you thirsty, they're gonna look straight at daddy. So it's, you know, if they're hungry, you know, a lot of times they look at the father, you know, so the man has a tough role. You have to just step up and take care of business and be responsible.
Good, thank you.
I guess in my house, what I remember, my parents, they both were there in the household, and my father, he wasn't an individual who actually went to church. My mom may have went sometime. So there wasn't really what you call a real spiritual foundation actually established, you know, pointing you to God. And so when you get older in life, that's what, you know, you know, you're gonna be like, kind of like a wild out, or you're gonna try to experience things, and what you saw in them, what they did, you tend to move toward that direction. So it's so important, that I guess when I grew up and my children, they came on the scene, that I wanted to be the example of a father, one that, you know, being committed to serve God. And as a result, you know, of that, you know, being faithful to God, but they see that within me, and they're in their own lives, they do once, first of all, made a commitment to God themselves. And then, of course, now they are adults and so forth, and live for God on their own accord. So that's why I say it's so important, you know, as a parent, you know, I just have to look back and think there was someone, even though my parents wasn't, you know, totally committed to God as we were when I was a kid, but there was someone somewhere praying for us to draw us to our Heavenly Father as it is now. So, you know, you should have that, you know, as a, you know, a person that has kids, you want to be that example before them, showing commitment, and, you know, being that covering or praying over them, and watch them over them, whatever they might be experiencing in life, to guide them. Because when they see you pray, then enough, you know, I think as a child, you begin to think, you know, that, well, who are you talking to? You know, you on your knees, they see you on your knees and praying to somebody. But over time, they will learn that this is how they would live as well. They know that you're praying of someone higher than yourself.
All right, thank you gentlemen for those great answers. Let me ask you this here. Why do so many fathers refuse to take leadership roles in the local church? Why do so many fathers refuse to take leadership roles in the local church?
The good reason for that is, again, going back to heritage, history has shown us that the male was never, well, probably in the earlier days, but not so much in the past 20 or 30 years, jobs, economy, everything like that kind of forced fathers to work harder, work longer. They often turn to alcohol and other substances to cover themselves because they were so stressed and, you know, trying to be a provider. So they just pretty much left it up to the woman of the house to handle that. And because of that, like you mentioned earlier, the house household suffered because the wife had to take that role in being the spiritual person in the house and also being the head of the house. Even though a husband or boyfriend may be there, they still had to carry that role. So our fathers dropped the ball and just continually to spiral downward.
All right, thank you for that answer there. Considering the state of the economy and the depressed job market, what is your opinion of stay-at-home fathers when the mother is the chief breadwinner?
That's a good question. Truly, as of 1994, I am a what you call a stay-at-home father due to injury I received at work. But the jobs haven't changed at all. My role is still head of the household. I am the spiritual leader of my family, and as I go, my family goes. So it's up to me to do the things that God would have me to do in order that my family would be blessed. And as soon as my eyes was open to that, and I realized that I need to get my life in line with what Christ had for me, the blessings start to come. I mean, we start to be blessed. The kids are doing great. We're just a happy family. But we have to get in line with God. And for the man of the house, whether you're the breadwinner or you're the stay-at-home dad, your role never changes.
Excellent. All right. Our last question here. I know you gentlemen have done a fantastic job. See some of you sweating over there, so we're going to wind it down. All right, so this question is, what can African-American fathers do to help the stem... Okay, let me repeat this. What can African-American fathers do to help stem the flow of incarceration, thus placing an undue burden on children and families? So in layman terms, how can we keep these young people from going to the pen?
What you can do. What you can do to keep these folks from going to the
pen? Yeah, what can African-American fathers do to help us steal the flow of incarceration, thus placing an undue burden on children and families? In other words, what they're saying is oftentimes when fathers are incarcerated, they're absent in the home, of course there's no economics coming in, there's no father figure, sometimes the discipline wanes, and so what can we do to stop that vicious cycle so we're not putting undue burden or stress on our wives or our families back home?
As men of God, fathers, and we are men of God, the world was up here, what we can do to help decrease the flow of a young man going into the prison institutions are, we can just be a beacon, be a light. Go out, talk with them, meet with them, show love toward them. There are a lot of young men that are out there on the streets that has never had a real man to come up to him and just hug him and say, man, I love you, man. Keep doing what you're doing. You're doing a good job. Just praise him, you know. Every man is an athlete in his heart. And every man needs someone to cheer him on, whether he's young or old. And as a man, if we go out and talk to these young men and teach them and just tell them, look, man, keep doing it. You can do it. You know, you don't have to fall into that. You know, just be a witness to them and show them by living the life that God has called us to live.
It's great, great. And in the conclusion of that, you gentlemen did a wonderful job of Father Knows Best. There's a show out there on television now. Some of you may have seen it. It's called The First 48. And I find it quite interesting. Anyone ever seen that show, The First 48? Okay, so we do got some TV watching. But anyway, there's a show called The First 48, and it's a very interesting show. There's some dynamics about the show that are interesting. And I guess the thing that kind of bothers me about the show is that 90%